Welcome to Azel's Place, and I was sharing that about an hour ago I received a call from my friend Larry Pearson in Canada, who felt like there was something going on, wondered if he was supposed to be on the web, and I believe that he is on, if I'm not mistaken. And until a few minutes ago, I didn't know what we were going to do, and I started discerning something new because Chuck, at least I remember that long, Chuck started talking about trees of healing and the tree of life, and I started feeling a vibration on my head, and I also feel some pressure behind my head, on the back of my head, rather. So if you turn to Zechariah chapter 4, and Brian, can you get Larry on, or is he signed up yet?
He's not online yet.
Thank you.
I think I'm here.
Larry, is that you?
That's me.
Welcome. Do you have your camera on?
I think so.
Okay, good. Oops. Yeah, we're going to be in Zechariah chapter 4, Larry. And I feel the tree of life. This is a brand new discernment. So I feel it right over here in my head. And the tree of life is vibrating, and I feel the trunk here, and the, I'm getting an echo, Brian, and the branches seem to go out like this. So Zechariah 4, now the angel who talked with me, this is 4:1, came back and wakened me as a man who was waking out of sleep, and he said to me, "What do you see?" And I said, I am looking, and there's a lampstand of solid gold, with a bowl on top of it, and on the stand, seven lampstands, and seven pipes to the seven lamps. Okay, so I'll pick on Brian. My son's come here first. And I write about this and come up higher. So you want to face that way. So the lampstand is right here. And here are the seven branches. Okay, and the bowl is right here, a golden bowl. And so out of the, okay, a lampstand of solid gold, the bowl on top of it, so the bowl is actually on top of your head, and on the stand, seven lamps with seven pipes. So out of the each lamp, there are seven pipes, and there are two olive trees are by it. So there's an olive tree here, and I believe these are the trees of life. Actually, in Genesis and Revelation, it does not say singular. It says on either side of the river was a tree of life. So, and what we think is that it's male and female. So for pollination. Exactly. That's why there's a tree on either. Remember, you have to be on the mic. So everybody needs to be on the mic if you talk. Well, the angels are the pollinators. There you go. I don't know. Okay, so there's two olive trees on one on the right of the bowl and the left. And then you go down to verse 11. And I answered and said, "What are these two olive trees at the right lampstand?" And I further answered and said to him, "What are these two olive branches?" So you have the olive tree is here, and then you have a branch that drips oil into the bowl. And there's a pipe that goes to each of the seven lampstands. Let your light so shine before me. See, the lampstand is always in the front. Verse 12, and I further answer, what are these two olive branches that dip into the receptacles of the gold pipes, which the golden oil drains? Then he said to me, "Do you not know?" I love it when the Lord says that. Do you not know? I don't have a clue. what these are. And I said, no, Lord. And he said, these are the two anointed ones who stand beside the Lord of the whole earth. So what I think now is actually that dimensionally we are always there as Christians. And with the two olive trees, so there are actually only two olive trees, but we are always there. Okay? You did a wonderful job.
Did I feel anything?
Did you feel anything?
I'm still learning
the
sensations.
Okay, so see if you can feel the olive tree in front, right here.
Can we have someone hold a mic for him, please?
Okay, Brian is trying to see if he can feel that. You feel that? Right there.
It stops right about
that's
here.
It.
So
that's the tree.
Feels like a root right here.
So. Yeah, it's actually the tree branches. So and the trunk would be right here.
Okay, I'm getting a little heat sensation right here.
So now what I feel is pressure on the back of my head, which tells me these are powers.
Okay.
And a power is a spiritual being. It's they're in charge of electromagnetic field. And I'm trying to remember the word now. Exousia is an authority and powers. Dunamis. So dunamis, these are electromagnetic.
Hey.
Okay.
And the Father is the power.
Awesome.
So it's all about electromagnetic energy.
Awesome. I do feel it.
Okay.
That's cool.
We're not making this up. Right. Okay, you can keep that. Okay, now if you go to Revelation, okay. I'm going to adjust my microphone.
Are you going to have,
All right, Revelation chapter 22. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. Now look at this. In the middle of the street and on either side of the river was tree of life. It does not say the in the Greek, which bore 12 fruits. I've always thought that too. That,
I missed it. I thought that.
Okay, you need to be on the mic.
I've always missed that. I thought that there was only one tree of life, and I've totally missed that right there.
Well, and that's what I was taught too.
Yeah.
And again, I think it does have to do with the male and female, so the pollination.
So do you think in my dream, because of my perception, I only saw one tree on the other side? Because I was on one side of the river.
You maybe only saw the one tree on the one side.
Yeah. Because he said, come over, and I said, I can't. I can't make it. It's too far.
I have noticed, for me and for other people, that we often perceive according to the way we believe. And so that we do not necessarily perceive what is reality in the spirit, but we are influenced by what we believe.
Believe in our heart.
One of the reasons why I believe this is true is that people, when they go to heaven, they say they see angels. Yep, they may be describing an elder, but you see, we have been taught, well, everything spiritual that's good are angels, everything that's spiritual and bad are demons. When reality is very, very complex. But we went through our own grid of understanding, I think. Okay, Larry, I feel like there's an angel here. I feel the tree of life, which is a power. And I have no idea where we're going with this. So if I can have you. Okay, good, Larry. So we're both in the same boat, so to speak.
Boat.
So you're in Canada, so this is a boat. Yeah, I can't see Larry yet.
Yeah, and you're gone fuzzy on me.
My fuzzy?
Yeah. What dimension are you guys in?
I am not sure. Okay, I think there is an angel here for the word. Oh, let me. Oh, there is Larry. I will open a document. My computer stays together.
I thought you got a new computer.
Yeah.
Not yet.
We have it.
It's coming.
Well, Lord, what do you want to do today?
So this is Larry Pearson, my friend, Toronto, Canada.
Hey.
Soon to move to Niagara on the lake, by the lake, near the lake. Somewhere by the lake.
Yeah. Closer to the river. Hopefully there'll be two trees.
Hey.
Lord, what are... I felt a lot of shifting going on before. I'm getting an echo, too.
Well, probably because you're... Are you using a headset?
Yeah. So you're saying if I take the headset off?
No, no, the headset should stop the echo. Oh, you don't, you're not talking into a headset mic, are you? Now I can't hear anything.
Now he needs a headset.
The joys of technical world.
Oh.
Okay, what he looks like he did is he unplugged the headphones, which will change the audio settings. So we've lost audio. I'll try to chat with him.
Okay.
And get that. I got
it. Here you are.
So, Larry, one thing is with that kind of a headphone, because the microphone is just dangling on the cord, it doesn't really pick up your sound very well. So... might ask if you could actually hold the microphone portion up a little closer to your mouth would be perfect.
See, I don't think that there's a microphone on this. But I could be wrong. I've been wrong once before this year.
Once?
Is that...
Yeah, I can hear you well, Larry.
Is that better?
Yes, that's actually better.
The microphone's on the other piece.
Whoa.
There we go.
This angel feels very strange. Does anybody see the angel?
I don't see the angel. I keep getting, with all the interference that's coming in, is all I get is the power of agreement. And it's between what you said, how we perceive by how we're taught, and then Chuck saying, I can't go over. You've seen the impasse, but the Lord is saying when you're in those areas, the power of agreement is he's given you all. When you're in that situation, he'll carry you. And that's what I'm getting right now. He needs to enter in to this what this angel has.
I feel like this. There are a lot of powers here, and I think this may be interfering with electromagnetic fields. For the
that's what I was about to say. Lord, where are we, and what do we need to do?
Yes.
When Brian was standing in the middle. I heard water.
Water.
Really quick. I could hear water. And then when David just said about the power of agreement, we have to agree with what the word is saying in order to cross over into that place in the spirit, to enter into the garden, to be able to perceive. We have to agree with what the word is saying. And then...
See, that's very interesting because we often agree about the way we were taught about the word rather than what the word says. I've had a lot of arguments with people, and very often I'll say, well, what does it say? And then they tell me, well, that's not what it means. I think, but what does it say? Well, that's not what it means. And I'm thinking, you know, you criticize me for not being biblical, but the reality is you're not biblical. We want to believe about what the word says. We want to write off the word. The gifts have all disappeared. They stopped at 100 AD. You know, it was a cessationism. And this is the kind of world, Christian world we live in. And in many ways, it's very pharisaical. It becomes very legalistic. Yes.
Now I heard the word fruit, and then I saw a shiny red apple.
Okay, fruit, red apple. Okay, Larry, how are we doing? Tobias. There is stuff behind and around the angel. Is it bad, or is he particularly partially trapped some other place? Okay, Tobias, I have no idea. So let me see. Here's the angel.
It's like a galaxy or something. Could it? Is that possible?
Anything's possible. Wait,
whatever you're touching intensifies this right here, Paul, above the ear. Yeah.
Huh. You know Tobias? It is like the angel is here, and then there's a door gate. There's a door right here. This is new. Like the angel is standing like this, and part of the angel we can perceive, but the other part is in this door. How did the door go? So I can't feel the angel on this side. So Lord, what are we supposed to pray?
Can I feel that?
Yes. So here's the door. Right here. No, here.
Okay.
Okay. Oh, yeah. See, there's nothing there. And I can feel the angel here. So Tobias, do you have any idea what we're to pray?
Okay, definitely feel this. Huh.
Is it because, like you said, that we need to enter into the agreement with the Word?
What I saw is, what I thought when you were saying that, is that we can see the angel on this side because the angel is calling for us to come, that what we can perceive and see, and then we can't. He's saying enter in through the agreement, enter in through the gate and through the door to be able to enter into that realm.
Well, the message is in the door. So
I've been seeing.
Okay, get on the mic.
I've been seeing a pattern, and the pattern looks like kind of like a garage door that opens up like this.
Uh-huh.
And it's like there's dark light, dark light, dark, and it's long slots that go across.
You just described the grid.
Yeah, right. Like a striped grid. And I've seen grids before, but I've not seen grids with that look like spreadsheets. You know, where you
Well, actually, it sounds like a checkerboard.
It's not a checkerboard. It's like solid. Like if his shirt was solid here, like this, like it's dark light, almost like, you know, it folds up.
Okay.
So it looks like it folds up, like it would be a door that goes up like this, as opposed to a door that opens like this.
Okay, like a garage door.
Yeah, like a garage door. That's what I'm trying to say.
But you saw two lines?
I saw several lines. They went up. Okay. And they were different in color, like there was light and then darker, light and then darker, light and then darker. Does that make sense?
Yes. No, I don't know if it makes sense, but... Maybe it feels like a line that goes into the generations, but it probably is not generational, but it feels like that. Mm. Yeah, I had a dream this morning, and in the dream, I saw two lines. There were two lines like this, and I had a sense maybe there were two dimensions. And there was a problem in between, and I had to fill in between the two lines with magazines, which I feel is information. So when you said two lines, it was very clear, and I had to stuff and fill this with information. So, Lord, what information do we need to fill in?
Earlier, I saw when we were talking about the tree.
Yes.
I was seeing the roots, and the roots were growing, and the roots were extending out.
Okay.
And it almost looked like the roots were going toward each, like us.
Okay, you need to put the mic in.
Oh, I'm sorry. The roots were headed toward each one of us as if they were grounding us, rooting us and grounding us. And I wasn't, because I wasn't sure what it all meant, I didn't want to say anything.
Hey, look at Colossians.
Okay.
Okay, it's okay, Colossians 2:6. As you therefore have received Jesus Christ the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith as you've been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the traditions of men, according to the basic principles of the world, not according to Christ.
Basic principles of the world.
Now, incidentally, the word basic principles is the word stoichia, which actually means elemental spirits. And for the ancients, philosophy and science, physics, mathematics, was used to understand the stoichia. And what happens is that you know, we now have been based, of course, on the Greek system rather than on the Hebrew system. Ryan.
We're getting lots of input. Okay. In order to get the timing correct, you want to read from the bottom and go up.
Okay, Sonia, I am now feeling that Jen is feeling, and I think it is part of the angel that is inside the door that we cannot see. It feels like we need a lateral connection from the left side to the right side of us, spirit, soul, and body. Mm. Tobias, I think the door is to the left of the first door. Okay, I think now, Tobias again, I think now I do see something here. Do we need to enter into the place the angel is trapped in by another door, not the door we discern now? Maybe it feels like a line that goes into the general. Okay, we've already read that one.
I have a question.
And Sonia, kind of like we need to develop laterally between left and
laterally.
Right brain hemispheres. Yes, that's it. Oh.
Yeah. So I want to ask you, what did you connect with?
The width, width?
Yes. You made a connection, height, depth, length.
Yeah,
width,
so that we know the height, length, depth, and width of Christ.
Oh, I
believe
that.
The width is the place of hope, faith, and love, which is, and trust. Okay, so...
I got something when you were talking about the angel in the middle. I closed my eyes for a second and I saw this angel had like a Roman armor on. And then he had something over his head, you know, something like, you know, what Jesus had over his head, you know. That, yeah. The vine or something. A vine.
Oh, okay.
Vine around his...
So like what the Greeks did with the Olympia?
Yeah, that's what I saw. And it was pretty clear when you were talking about the angel right by the door. Right,
it's very clear. There. This is all really very clear.
Paul, yes. I'm getting through when we were sharing about the roots. It's to connect us. That's why we're having that interference. But the connection is what you've been reading about faith,
yes,
to enter in. But it's faith in God, not what we've been...
Not according to the systems of the world.
And that's what you said, trust. But the door, I feel that
the
door that you have, I've been kept on getting revelations where you shared about John, and it said, come up here, or there
Revelation
was a door.
Revelation 4:1.
That's what I'm getting.
The door opened to heaven, and the Lord said, come up here. Okay? So, Tobias, you don't think that this is the door that we're supposed to go through, that there's another door? Do you know where the other door is, Tobias? Help me here.
I think we're supposed to come out.
Say again?
I had a feeling we're to come out.
We're come out of...
Okay, I'd like to bring Tobias up so you can talk with him as well.
Thanks, Brian.
Tobias, go ahead, please.
Okay, can you hear me?
We can hear
you. Oh, hold on. I need to start my video. Connection is really bad. That's why I turned off the video. Do you hear me, Brian?
I can hear you. I can hear you, Tobias.
Okay. Could you put your hand on the door again, please,
so
Paul?
This is the door where the angel seems to be stuck right here.
Yeah. Paul, I had the sense that it's to your left, but when you touch it, I think you have to go around, like, right to get to the other door. Mm. The other door is right to your left, but you have to go
Right
here. Right to get
that,
to it.
There's
that.
Actually a door right here.
There really is.
Is that the door?
No. could you turn around left ball? No, the other.
The other left?
You mean right.
The other left, there you go.
This way?
No, to the other way around, Paul.
This way?
Yeah, your left. And now make a short circle, like bypass your computer.
Oh.
Your computer.
Go this way? It's like
Yes. Okay. But a circle, and come back almost to where you started.
Okay.
To the left, almost where you started. And there, I think there is a door.
Right here is a door. And it's interesting. Now, the door.
Yay. Gate.
There's a door here, but this is a bronze door. So this is a contaminated door. So this is the problem then.
When Jenna said we got to come out, I think he's saying we got to come out of ourselves, all of the religiosity or anything, our mindset of what we think or perceive is going to happen here, and say, come new. Let the Lord come to us to bring us into this. That's what I feel about that door right there.
Religious.
Actually, Paul?
Yes.
When you just said that, I had the same sense. Like, this bronze door is our mindsets. Like, we've become that inflexible in our mindsets about God and certain things, and that has placed the bronze door into place.
Religious mind. Yes, mind. I think it's right. It is a mind. It's mindsets. It's religious mindsets.
Like a stronghold or fortress in the mind, but negative.
Yeah. I think it's much what you were discussing earlier about our perception. We perceive something to be true on our own grid, but yet not knowing how to come out of that or where we're going.
You know, what amazes me about this is we were just talking.
Mm-hmm.
I was just, this happened, it's so amazing that we're just talking, and that becomes the toggle where we're supposed to go. So here it is. Yes.
And what I was getting was,
there's a header on it.
We got to come out in order to come in. And like me, I'm sensing like, hurry, let's go in now. Like, there's a bunch of activity. There's stuff to run into. And I'm like, I want to go in.
Okay. So we have to come out. So
what is the header? I'm just curious, Paul, because I see this header up there, and I just wonder if anybody could see what's written on this header.
Oh, it's right here. I don't know, but whatever this is tied to evangelism.
Is it really?
It is.
Or the hindrance of it.
It's not. It's right there. There's something about evangelism. It's contaminated evangelism right here. It's like a knob or something, it's contaminated evangelism.
Hmm.
Am I still on?
You are still on. And Tobias?
Am I still allowed to talk here? I don't know. When Jenna just said that, I had the sense it's like trying to convince people by our own logic and power.
Yes. I believe that's true. Okay. I'm now in the place that we need to come out of. I can feel it, and it is really yucky. Yes. Jenna, come stand here.
And then what I was getting was, do not enter. And then it's the same scripture.
This door says do not enter?
The header that the she was talking above the door, the banner, or do not enter. And it's pertaining to that same scripture in Matthew. Remember how you found the scripture last?
Yes.
How they don't enter into the kingdom, and they stop those from entering in. And this is what I feel that that it's saying, like, in other words, you don't enter into these things. Yeah, don't.
Okay, that's Matthew 23:13. But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for neither do you go in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in.
It doesn't want us to enter in.
Yes.
Because it knows that if we enter in through that door that goes beyond just evangelism, salvation, beyond that, into the kingdom of God, all these things that we're learning about, the curses won't be broken off, the generational curses, we won't receive the generational blessing, the fullness of what Christ wants to give us.
So stand right there. So this feels
wow,
really disgusting.
I don't feel anchored or grounded at all.
Okay, Don just wrote, I'm discerning witchcraft. Not exactly what it feels like here, but it's, you know what this is? This is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. You want to come here and feel this? You want to come here?
Yeah. Let me.
So, and if you're on the web, you just, by faith, it is. I am standing in the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, but it's a religious system.
Right, and where this is tied in, I think, in agreement to the principles of the world.
Yes.
And it's not what we've described in the Bible as principality. It's a system that we've unknowingly agreed with through religious mindset. Yeah. So this is what the roots were going out so far. The foundation.
Okay, you need to move the mic.
Mics.
Right here, Brian's hand.
The interesting part about the roots were that they were...
Oh. Eat the mic.
They were twisted, and there were some gnarls on them.
Yes.
And so I was like, well, what is that? Why are the roots... coming at us, yeah, and they were trying to get it. They were trying to come at us. They were going at us, and I was thinking, why? You know, if we're here and we're trying to get grounded in, you know, with God, then why would the tree roots be coming at us? And why are they twisted and gnarly and coming at us? And that was the reason why I didn't want to say anything, because I didn't have any kind of discernment upon it.
This goes back to what we did last time in the coaching, where we do not want to do it God's way. And we sit around in our committee meetings and we discuss why we must do it this way or that way, and we project, we plan, rather than inquiring on the Lord. And so, okay. All right, you can be seated. Tobias, is this the foundation of the church which was laid early on in the Christian history? Yes. This actually goes back to Constantine. Now, Constantine, of course, was the one who totally annihilated the Jewish and Hebrew influence and established church buildings and that concept of coming out of the home and going into buildings. Of course, all the buildings were pagan buildings.
One thing, when you were talking about the contaminant sign on there,
yeah.
I was actually smelling in the air a strong gassy smell, you know?
Gassy, so, like natural gas? Or?
No, it was like a foul. It was foul.
Foul.
Yeah.
So, why don't we pray this? Lord, we renounce and repent for.
Lord, we renounce and repent for.
Believing what we want to believe about the Bible.
Believe in the Bible.
And the kingdom of God.
And the kingdom of God.
Rather believing in what the Bible actually says.
Rather than believing what the Bible actually says.
We repent for arguing.
We repent for arguing.
And philosophical arguments.
And philosophical arguments.
And religious arguing.
And religious arguments.
Rather than trusting in you.
Rather than trusting you.
And doing it your way.
And doing it your way.
Again, Lord, we repent for not inquiring of you.
Again, Lord, we repent for not inquiring of you. And I'm getting a scripture that keeps resonating, is come out from among them, be holy as I am.
Well, and Lord, we choose to come out.
Lord, we choose to come out.
Of that system.
Of that system.
And walk into your kingdom.
Your kingdom. This just took off.
We choose not to shut up the kingdom of God.
We choose not to shut the kingdom of God.
To ourselves.
To ourselves.
Or to others.
Or to others.
We choose to go in and to go out.
We choose to go in and to go out.
According to your direction.
To go into your direction.
Now, Lord, please remove this bronze door and these iron bars.
Lord, please remove the bronze doors and these iron bars.
Yeah, so that's Matthew 23:13. That's right. Okay. Now it's clean. So I think that we can walk through. So you want to come around this way. And Lord, we choose to walk in. Then we'll see what happens to the
this
angel and the message.
Am I crazy?
I don't know, when I walk through, my evangelism finger is going off.
Oh, I guess we're going to get there.
I believe this is all about evangelism.
I do too. I like this, whatever this is.
In fact, all my fingers are vibrating now.
The fivefold.
The foundation.
The restored foundation.
Yeah, wherever you are, you can also walk through by faith. I think what we're doing prophetically and in reality is we're walking through. I want to go back to my dream. I wonder if I misinterpreted the dream.
What's the dream again?
The two lines, but I was stuffing man's information in between. That's what the magazines are. I was stuffing and trying to fill up, but by doing that, I was actually blocking access to the dimension.
Can I also add this? Magazines are information pertaining to words and pictures.
Yes.
And pictures are the long-term memory.
Okay. And Ronis has an interesting statement. I agree. And Laura, we come against fear of coming against man's ways.
Fear of coming against man's ways.
See, this is what happened. I was a pastor, so I can say this. But what we do as pastors, see, is we determine what is right and what's wrong, rather than together seeking the Lord.
Hmm.
Yes.
When you were talking about the bronze gates and the iron doors, and that says, "Oh, ye gates, be lifted up that the King of Glory may enter in."
Yeah,
and
Psalm 24.
And then also, but the King of Glory has to come out of us. So if we have those bronze gates and doors, he can't come out because we won't allow him because of our way of thinking, what we've been taught pertaining to the word, and that's for the deeper levels of the realms where he wants to take us into. But those gates and doors have to be removed.
I think that was the gate. In other words, we in our three dimensions have dealt with that gate that blocks the kingdom from coming out. Mm-hmm. I agree.
And one more thing, very quickly. Yeah. What I saw a few minutes back was I saw a set on me right here was a gold, like...
The ephod?
Oh, okay. It was like this, and it was gold, and it was set on me like this.
Yeah, so square, that would be the ephod.
Okay.
So now I feel the angel, Tobias, to see how we're doing. Okay. Now the angel, I think, is fully here. So, Larry, I think we're ready to have you come back.
Ow, right
there. That's interesting. The angel's not cut in half anymore. It's almost like caught between two opinions.
Yeah, just like your slats, the two lines.
So, in James, where you're unstable all your ways, because you're caught between two opinions.
Exactly.
Where, you know, we have one foot in the world and one foot in heaven, and we have the pull of the church.
The church. Exactly.
Was trying to pull us into that system. Right.
I'm just reminded of the prayer we have against double-mindedness.
Yes.
I'm too.
Are we supposed to pray that, do you think? Maybe you find that, Brian. So, okay, Larry?
Yes.
There you are. A voice from heaven.
Yes.
Okay, I think now maybe we might be ready to receive the message.
Thank you, Lord.
Ouch. You better release it.
You've chosen well. This day I transfer your steps. out of the earthly dominated life, and into a greater revelation of being in sonship. Mm. For too long, you have been trapped in the pirate ship.
For too long. Mm.
That's good.
Where orphans have ruled over you.
Wow. Distortion evangelism.
There is a line of demarcation upon the leadership of the lands. True sonship and authentic leadership will now rise like a fountain of life connected to the tree of life, which is the kingdom that is coming to earth. Embrace your sonship, and it will be smooth sailing.
The second one. Embrace your sonship. Okay.
And it will be smooth sailing as you understand who you are, where you are, and where you're going. I will carry you into new heights. Mm. For shackles are coming off of your steps that have kept you earthbound. I'm releasing a flood of light to the eyes of understanding on whoever is toward me, turned toward me.
Okay, I'm releasing a
flood of light.
Flood of light to the eyes of your understanding.
To all those that are turned toward me.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
There is a recovery of understanding coming upon the ecclesia. Faith and understanding need to take root.
Interesting idea of root.
Before, you have heard it's all about your thinking. Now it's about your believing.
Absolutely.
The double-mindedness comes from being persuaded of philosophy.
I'm sorry, hang on. Before, you heard it's all about your thinking. Now it is about your faith?
No.
Your believing.
Believing, okay.
The double-mindedness comes from believing the philosophies and traditions of men. Faith and understanding need to be established upon the truth. This is a season of rewiring the chambers of the heart to believe believe the truth. Take heed what you hear, for the measure that you hear, it will be measured back to you.
I got that this morning.
Connect it to the heart, believe. Okay.
Connect to the heart.
Okay. Take heed what you hear, for the measure will be
measured unto you.
The measure that you hear will be measured back to you.
Okay. Okay.
Oh, I forget the last part of what I said.
I'm sorry.
It's okay.
I'm listening to you, and I'm processing and thinking and typing and
holding his computer together.
I'm holding my computer together.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, bring
it. Yeah, the measure of your heart belief will determine the measure of your metron. Whoa.
Will determine the measure of your what?
Metron.
How do you
spell metron.
M-E.
Sphere of authority.
Your sphere.
It's a ruling position.
With the heart, man believes. Take heed what you believe. That's it.
This is pretty amazing, authentic. I think maybe yesterday I had a prayer session, and we started going into the whole concept of believing. And what had happened is the client's mother, who tends to be a negative person, came in and simply asked her daughter, "Well, how are you feeling?" And she'd been having stomach problems. Immediately, the daughter started having stomach problems again, and she'd been all right. And so we started exploring this, and there's this verse: as a man thinks in his heart,
so he is.
So is he. And actually, Jen has been on this kick. You know, Jen gets on these kicks, and I'm just trying to figure out, you know.
Larry probably started it.
Yeah, probably. And we started searching the whole idea that not only is it what we say that can cause trouble, but what we think.
Yeah.
And actually then the thinking, and then this got really, really complicated because the thinking was like a fractal coming down the generational line. Mm. And so, for example, my parents would have a way of thinking, then I mirror that thinking in that belief system, and it keeps on going, it keeps on going, it keeps on going. Generationally, and then that thinking is also tied to ungodly authorities, which are curses, and so it's, which also is tied to ungodly elders that sit at the gate. And then we got to the 70 elders that were at the gate in Ezekiel chapter 8, which we talked about last time, I believe. And so, the 70 is the Sanhedrin, which is man's system.
Hey.
And so this all gets really, really complex. And so, Larry, when you gave this word, it's exactly the same. Take heed of what you hear, for the measure will be measured back to you. The measure of your heart belief will determine your sphere of influence.
Absolutely.
What was the word you used? Metron?
Metron.
What is that?
Metron, your sphere.
It's
where Paul talks about the sphere of his. He won't go beyond his sphere or his metron.
I actually wrote about that in my book, and I can't remember how to spell that.
You know, it's true. You really can't go.
Metron, isn't it? I think.
I'll check.
I think he's right. Yeah. But it is true. You really can't go beyond your belief of your self-worth in your heart. You can proclaim it all you want, but if it's not rooted in your heart and belief and experienced in that truth, then you're not going to function beyond it.
So here I go to what I've always believed, which I wonder is now is not...
Default.
Is not true. I'd always believed and taught that, okay, I believe something, and then it comes out in actions or in words. Mm-hmm. And then that's the problem. But maybe we go... It appears we have to go back one step. That even the thinking establishes a pattern that actually affects the spiritual world that we are in. That we have to guard. We have to guard. Does it say somewhere guard your heart? Guard your heart. Where's that? Guard your heart.
Guard your heart. Guard your heart, for out of it flow the issues of life, which actually can mean the boundaries of our life.
That's right. I think we're reading the same.
Okay, go ahead, Chuck.
I used to have anxiety real bad, and what I started praying, it took me a long time, but I started asking God, what is this, what is what's going on? And what happened was I started listening to my own voice in my head, and that's what was causing the anxiety. And now I help other people that have it, mm-hmm. and I tell them, listen to what you're saying, because the things that are going on in your head is things like, I don't feel good, I got to get out of here. You know, all these kind of things. And I tell them, now change those into positive Bible verses and memorize those verses every time you have those feelings. Right. And so it is true, whatever you think, you actually make yourself, and you can work yourself into where you're in the hospital.
Well, yes, and I was an expert at that.
I actually believe, again, back to the belief of your heart, the minute you try to go beyond that belief is when you have anxiety.
Okay, we have several things going. Guard your heart, Proverbs 4:23. Thank you so much, Ronice. Can Paul repeat what he said about being caught between two opinions, also being pulled by the church system? I guess what I'm saying is that it appeared that that in this image here of the angel that we could perceive and what we could not perceive, is that we have our feet planted in the institutional church, and another foot planted in heaven, and that these two seem to be diametrically opposed to one another. And though we try to convince ourselves that's not true, this is what the hard thing is. We try to convince ourselves, well, that's not true. I shared with you that many years ago, the Lord, I believe, told me to stop attending the institutional church. Now, I'm not against the institutional church. So I have to be really careful about this, because I get myself in so much trouble. It's like racism. I says, well, I have many friends that are pastors. and there's many churches that I would go to. But my difficulty is that the Lord actually had to beat out of me that system, because I pastored for almost 20 years. And so, I talk about my journey, not your journey. So don't impose your journey on my journey or vice versa, right? We all need to do what the Lord says to do. But it took me a long time to get out of that system. Many years ago, I had a dream, and in the dream, I was against a wall. And a voice was talking to me, and I think it was the Lord now. And the Lord said to me, your blood pressure is 197, which I respond in my dream, but I'm not under stress. And then he says, it's about your thinking.
I
talked to everybody. I said, what does this mean? What does this mean? I remember so clearly. I was in Australia.
What was the psalm?
And all the, you were there, I think.
Well, I wasn't in Australia, but there was a psalm that came out of that.
Yes.
That I.
Well, then I realized in Australia that it's Job 19:7. So if you look at Job 19:7, and then Brian will pray that prayer. Okay, Roni says, how do you get to that place of in between? I think we get into that place of in-between because we listen to reasoning, we listen to philosophy. When I was in seminary, I think I spent more time studying Greek philosophers and theologians than I did. In fact, I had no chorus, no class on any book of the Bible or on prayer in all my seminary. Not one. But I studied lots of theologians, and lots of philosophers. Well, what are theologians? Many times theologians integrate human philosophy with the Bible.
Interesting. You're right.
And that's theology. And this is when we get ourselves in trouble. And I watched many, I was older when I went to seminary, but I watched many kids come in and their faith was destroyed. And you see, because what happens is rather than training people to listen to God, to understand the word, we go a different way. And that gets us caught in between two places.
Can I say something on that too?
Okay, just a second.
Okay.
Sonia, a beam of light shone on my brain. I could see black dots being burned up in my brain. Interesting. Okay, and Tobias, with the saying of Paul, I think we are ready to receive the message. Something, okay, we just did that. And he sees a waterfall.
Yeah, that's what I'm feeling here.
Okay, now, and then we'll go back to you. Job 19:7, if I remember my dream right.
I'm sorry. I got ahead of myself again.
Okay, Job 19:7. This is man's thinking. If I cry out concerning wrong, I am not heard. If I cry aloud, there is no justice. And then Psalm 19:7.
Psalm 19:7. That's what I was thinking.
I hope I remember this right. Yes, Psalm 19:7.
That's right.
This is man's thinking. I cry out concerning wrong, I am not heard, and there is no justice. Psalm 19:7, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. So that's the law of the Lord. Isn't it interesting? It converts. There's the evangelism. Okay, Chuck?
I was just going to say, Terry and I went to seminary school as well, and we left because they kept saying, don't do this, and don't go to this church, and they kept criticizing these churches, and so we thought, they criticized Jesus, you know, and we said, let's go to that church. And it was Vineyard.
Oh!
And so that's where everything opened up to us.
That's right. That was good. Yes.
I have a few things, Paul. Let's see. What we were saying about the thinking, it's the abundance of the heart. That's what the Lord is trying to tell us, to look at our abundance of our heart through our thinking, our emotions, and what we've set our will to. And then a lot of things, our mindset, like in the church, or we're saying in this religious sect, is that we stand in that place of God, and we're aligning with the authorities that are opposing what God wants to do in creation. So we think it's totally just us when it's what we're aligning ourselves with. That's the two difference of opinions, because we want to stand in that place saying we're okay.
Yeah, can I?
Let me say something. Then you're going to talk.
All right.
In quantum physics, and a lot of people actually incorporate this into novels. And I've written some of these novels. They're like New Age, it just totally eliminates God. But in quantum physics, they have noticed that the observer affects creation. So if you watch an atom, as soon as you look at an atom, you affect it. Interesting. You look at it. It's interesting. I just realized. You don't talk to it even. Just observing it affects it. Well, you see, this is faith, isn't it? The righteous way of looking at it is, this is faith that we affect in Christ. And this is the difference. See, we're always doing this in Christ. It's not that we're manipulating, controlling, making stuff happen.
That's right.
But we're always doing it in Christ. It's according to His will, according to His direction, according to His word. And could it be that even in our thinking, that we have affected in a negative way because we have accepted the thinking patterns that come down a generational line, which is the fractal again, the repeating of it. And I go back to my first prophetic dream, that when we dealt with that fractal, then everybody was healed. See, I really do believe there's secrets of the kingdom the Lord is exposing us. Now, Jana, finally, I'm going to get to you.
Thank you. Back to 23:7, Proverbs 23:7. So
Proverbs
23:7. Yeah.
Just look at that.
And I realized something. So she had asked, how do we get that in-between state where we're bartering, and that's what we're doing. We're bartering between two opinions. One we know is true, and one is an established thought through a judgment, opinion, or a decision we made. And if you look at Proverbs 23:7, it says, as he thinks, and the word is shah, which really means gatekeeper. So we set up this judgment in a fault, in a wrong guardian over our hearts, so he is. So he's actually stuck in a realm of his own creation, be it good or not, and he's wavering between these two opinions to accommodate his environment.
Yeah, I think that we need to study more carefully the whole context, which is interesting. Proverbs 23,
the whole context is
5.
Yeah.
Will you set your eyes on that which is not?
The eyes are important.
For riches certainly make themselves wings and fly away like an eagle towards heaven. Do not eat the bread of a miser, nor desire his delicacies, for as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Mm-hmm. Eat and drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you. So I think that, I feel like we need to really study this more carefully.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's some treasures here.
I do.
About the whole area of thinking.
The other thing, you mentioned eyes. I think this is really important. The last 3 or 4 days, I wrestled with that idea. I had something come on me, and I went, oh, I thought these days were over. I mean, really, I'm wrestling with a demon. And I just, this is enough of this. Okay, and I realized it's something to do with my eyes that came in.
Okay, let's go back to Zechariah 4. In the session, we got to a stone.
Mm-hmm.
But I do not get at that part yet. And this had to do with sub-dimensions. Mm. Remember we talked last time about sub-dimensions? Well, look at Zechariah 3:9.
Oh.
And then we're going to pray the double-mindedness prayer. Zechariah 3:9. For behold, the stone that I have laid before Joshua, upon the stone are the 7 eyes.
Well,
remember, are the 7 eyes of the Lord or the 7 eyes of the Lamb. Are the 7 eyes. Then you go to Zechariah 4:10. For who has despised the day of small things? I think about fractals again.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at a fractal, it takes a large image and repeats it until it gets smaller and smaller until the very original is small.
Paul.
For these some rejoice to see the, and actually this is the word stone, it's not plumb line, to see the stone in the hand of Zerubbabel, and on the stone are the 7 eyes of the Lord. So I don't know, there's something about that stone, I don't know, and the word stone could be, may also be the perhaps the stokia, which is the elemental stone, or it could be, it may be the fiery stones. Well, actually, when I say fiery stone, remember Lucifer walked among, mm-hmm. or Lucifer walked among the fiery stones. Okay, why don't we pray this prayer together in double mindedness? Okay. Okay. Can everybody see that online also, Brian? Here we go. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I confess my doubt and the doubt in my generational line. I confess that this doubt has made me unstable and has given me double-mindedness. I confess that the source of this double-mindedness has been pride in my life and in my generational line. I also repent for all intellectualism, ungodly reasoning, logic, and humanism. I repent of caring more about man's approval rather than God's truth. I repent of my own self-effort and pride. God, in humility, I receive your love, mercy, and grace. I choose to be no longer conformed to the pattern of this world, but to you, being transformed by the renewing of my mind so that I might prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I will do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but I will walk in humility, considering others better than myself. I choose to resist the devil. I choose to submit myself to God as my Lord and Master, and to draw near to him. Lord, please wash my hands and purify my heart. Father, thank you. Thank you. Okay, let's see where we are.
Father, thank you
for giving me the mind of Christ, so I will be like him, becoming like a servant. Amen. Let's take a brief 5-minute break. Welcome back. I want you to be aware that we have several free resources on our website, and we've released down Spiritual Servants of the Most High God and Biblical Basis for Spiritual Conflict as free downloads now. And also, there are many of the podcasts that we have recorded, Brian has recorded over the last several months that you can go and listen to. I was sharing with Chuck that when we first started doing this, I felt like we would be doing training in basic discernment. But what happened is every time we get together, the Lord is not content just to do that. So he's always pushing us into new revelation, which frankly is more fun for me because that other I know how to do. But then we integrate. Isn't it interesting how we integrate what we've already learned into the new so that we are actually doing that? And going back, we have not prayed this prayer, don't mind this prayer, probably for years. So it was a great idea, Brian. Yes, you may say something.
On those prayers, it's amazing to me when we do go back and what's in them.
It is.
You know, and we've done this stuff, but yet it's, I'm not on. How am I now? Am I okay? Thank you. So anyway, I'm amazed that when we do go back on these prayers, the revelation is unfolding even now today. And the other thing about biblical basis, I encourage you to look at that. That was so fundamental for me in understanding what we're doing. And even now, if you go look at that and go, oh, this is why, it'll connect the dots for you and give you some real revy. So I just want to encourage you.
Okay, then you have something else to add about the stone and the foundation?
Oh, but when Paul was reading out of Zechariah.
So let's go back to Zechariah.
4. And this also is kind of in light of something we did a webinar or two ago. Webitar?
A webitar.
Webitar. What's that, Brian?
It was like.
Oh, my gosh. Lord, you know. He was reading, I'm just going to read in Zechariah 4. It says, also the word of the Lord came to me saying, the hands...
Four, what verse?
Eight.
Eight, okay.
Also the word of the Lord came to me saying, the hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this house, and his hands will finish it. Then you will know that the Lord of hosts has sent me, for who has despised the day of small things? And interesting enough, I think that's exactly what has happened with the grid and the understanding and the principles of the world that have influenced the church, how we were stuck in that. But we're making a way to the original foundation. The stones are that foundation.
Yes. Okay, I'm sitting here, of course, thinking, what are we going to do next? And Chuck, you want to say something?
No, I just...
Okay. And so we started with the Tree of Life. Remember that? That was several hours ago. Start with the Tree of Life. So now I'm feeling the Tree of Life again. Mm. And I feel it as a power. So I feel powers back here in my head. Where I also feel rulers and the Father as the power.
I got a scripture
and
on that.
There's a, okay, what's the scripture? And then I also feel the tree vibrating. There's like a hum or it's a vibration to it.
Okay, this is my understanding.
Okay.
And why we started with the tree and a lot of what Larry was saying in Genesis 1:11.
Genesis 1:11.
Someone said they had a lot of influence with 1:11.
Oh, Genesis 1:11. There you go. 1:1:1 again.
Gosh, I can't even find it.
That's the first book in the Bible.
That it is. God said, let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed. It's all a seed war, which are the original stones. Yeah. Yielding seed and fruit trees on the earth, bearing fruit after their own kind with seed in them. And it was so. And this is the evangelist connection.
Not only that.
Is that fractals too?
It is.
Well, I think...
And you see, if you go way back the family line, the original seeds could be bad seeds that then produce more bad seeds. In the session with this lady, she saw a a spider with baby spiders. And I've always been curious about that, and I realized that's the seeds for the next generation. So then you have the curse, which is a spider, which is what I operate in if I'm cursed. But then I am also in the process of passing that on to the next generation.
Ow.
And you know, you talk to enough people and you see the same patterns in the family line. Why? Because there's the seeds.
It's a seed war.
Before I even started.
Now it's not just Star Wars, it's seed wars.
Mm-hmm. Before I even got submitted to the Lord and doing what he wanted to do, I would get up and just say, the curse stops here.
Yes.
The curse stops here. Because my family line is just a big mess. And there's no consistent godliness throughout any of the generations. And I would just always say, the curse stops here. I never understood why I said it, but that's what I always said. And then after I started submitting to the Lord, I understood.
Yeah, we are in a time in history where there's a lot of woe and doom. And my degree was in history, and I read a lot of history and a lot of novels. And you know, life has always been really, really difficult. And there's been a lot of bad stuff. And it is true that we see an acceleration on a national level of evil. We see that. I'm not discounting that. But I want to also submit to you that we have probably never seen in the history of the world more prayer that's going on than we see now. And I don't know that we've ever seen more understanding about blessings and curses than what's going on now. I believe that we've not seen more people understanding what it means to be in Christ and to be fruitful than we see now. Now, we can focus on what the church is not doing, and what the world is doing, and what government is doing. Mm. But see, maybe we need to focus more on the curse stops here. Mm. Now, I look at my generational line. Mm. I know that my children and grandchildren are different because of what happened to me. You know, I have no patience with anybody who says, well, I don't believe what you're doing. I says, well, I don't even care anymore about that. Because I can tell you that my marriage is different, that my family is different, that my grandchildren are different. Mm. Than they would have been if we had not known this. So this is where I think we need to focus, and this is what gives hope for the children that we work with. Mm. Mm. There's a real danger in talking about the end of the world for children, because then their children think, well, what's the hope? Point?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. It's a why bother syndrome. Is the left behind syndrome. What, okay, if the end is near, and it may be, but you see that if we're in Christ, that there's always something for us to do, mm-hmm. and we are stopping what has been so inherent in our family line.
You know,
and this all goes to the fact that the Lord, the Father's coming back for a pure bride. And I think this is what's happening, isn't it? That he is purifying us in the church.
Hmm. Yeah. This, what you're saying, I never realized before how much philosophy, other religions, the Mayan, the whole spiel, is always to a doomsday end. Yeah. I didn't realize that.
Well, you know, it's actually karma, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's karma. Yeah. Karma is that, you know, you reap what you sow, rather than grace, which says I can overcome what's been sown in me.
Right.
I know someone that's very close to me, and it's constantly the end time, the end time. And this person is so gifted, because I've known them as a child. They're so gifted, and yet they won't operate in the gift, because all they do is think about that end time.
They've destroyed their hope.
They won't operate. They have a wonderful gift, and yet they won't use it, because all they do is talk about that.
Which is anxiety, by the way.
Yeah. You know, and theologically, I need to explain that I do not disagree that things globally are a mess. But you see, we are operating in the kingdom, and we operate under the king, and so we're doing what the king says to do, and we are at war. And I am not a dominion theology person, and the dominion theology, which is becoming very popular in some segments, even in the charismatic and you know, in the movement and the river movement, which says that things are going to get better and better and better, and we're going to slip right into the kingdom. I do not see that. But I do see that I need to operate in the kingdom. And I do see that we are positive, that we are Christ-like, that we are at war, and that we are overcoming, mm-hmm. and that we are going to be a purified bride, mm-hmm. which Christ is going to come for his mm-hmm. bride. And it will be without spot and blemish, because I think we are learning to deal with all the yuck and the thinking and the heart attitudes and the mindset that have come against us.
Yes. I've always felt that things are getting worse and worse and worse. Therefore, the kingdom will come out of everybody that are operating in the kingdom. It's going to get better and better and better from that perspective. You'll know more in the spirit, in other words, because
That's
of
right.
what's happening worse on the outside.
And I think this is the great day for the next generation. Because I think this generation is going to look at the world system and say, this is not working. Mm. And we see the best days for evangelism coming in that generation. I think with our youth, because what do youth do? They rebel against the status quo. And what's the status quo? Well, it doesn't matter what you believe. Everything is all right. The majority decides what is right. They're going to come back and they're going to say, we need a standard mm. of righteousness and holiness, mm-hmm. which is this book. Mm-hmm. Anyway, end of sermon.
This is just a quick aside, but there was a prophet who said, he was reading all these headlines. The Lord had showed him all these headlines. And he said on one of the headlines, it said, it's going to look like the Christian church is in major retreat, but that's when the Spirit of the Lord gets poured out the most. And that just made my spirit leap, because that's what I've always believed. I've always felt that was how Lord was going to do it, you know?
That's right.
And so it just made me leap. And what you've been talking about is like total confirmation of everything that, you know, that I've always felt. So it was really cool.
Yeah, we need to have hope. And it's hope not in the world. And the government. The government is not our hope. The Lord is our hope. Ryan.
A prophet once told me he had a vision, and he saw a church that was trying to be built, but we were doing it under our own strength, and we're using, hand tools instead of giving these power tools which God is giving us. And I thought that was really understanding of what's going on today. You know, we're trying to use it on our own strength instead of going by the rule book of God, and he's giving us the power tools.
My friend Jana has a great phrase. When people come against what we're doing, and then she simply says, well, and how's that working for you? And the truth is, it is not working. You know, it's that classic description of insanity. Insanity is repeating the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. And the reality is that it's not working. Now, this is a very lonely stage right now for us, isn't it? I said last time, what we're doing is not seeker sensitive. We do not have a million people in here. We don't even have 50. Because you see, this is very lonely right now. And I keep on saying to the Lord, okay, I'll keep on doing this, but then I have the phrase, well, where's the beef? Well, now we're starting to see trickles of fruit, you know, that I have never seen before in my life. Never. I've seen things happen in my life that I've never seen before, which makes me think, well, maybe we need to keep on going. But you see, we don't know if we're right if we stop. Back in the 1990s, when we had lost our house, we actually had moved in with a college student because he had a house. We couldn't find a place to rent. We couldn't find a place to buy. We were running out of money. And still, all of our stuff was in storage. And I remember Don and I sat in our bed, and we thought, do I just go back to teaching? I have my secondary teaching credential. Do I just go get a job? And I actually went and tried to find a job. But the only thought that kept on coming to me is, I don't know if I'm wrong if I stop. You see, we are at the point. My friend Rob Gross, who I love dearly, in Hawaii, pastor of Mountain View Community Church in Kaneohe, he says that the Harvard did a study, and the initiators are like 2 or 3%. Mm. Well, what's another word? Initiators, but
creative.
Yeah, when you start something new, and it doesn't matter what discipline you're in, whether it's art or mathematics or physics or music.
Very few.
When you cross over into doing the new and the unusual, you are rejected virtually by everybody. That's the nature of it. Now, the reality is, so are crazy people. So you don't know, you know, am I an initiator or am I crazy? See, you don't know. Except, I have this thing that I will be radically obedient to the Lord. Mm. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to be...
Even if it doesn't look normal.
Right. There's something right here now. I do this sometimes. With, oh, there's something there. So we want to be radically obedient. Now, there's been enough fruit now. Mm-hmm. And I'll go back to another statement. You know, I said to the Lord, well, I do this because there's fruit.
Hey.
And I can remember...
I
met a man who had given us like $70,000. I had gone from like a very poor salary as a pastor, and in 1998 we moved up to Idlewild and we started receiving checks. One check was for $50,000. I had never made that much money in a year as a pastor, and he kept on saying. He kept on saying, this is for you, it's not for the ministry you're involved with. And so we started collecting the bank, which eventually helped start Asa's place. And sometime later I met him, and I actually said this on a tape, and he told me later, he says, I never said that, but he did. We sat at the table, and it was a very, very nice Chinese restaurant, and he said to me, this is how we started the meal out. I don't know why I gave you all that money. You have not helped me or my son. Now that's a wonderful way to start a meal. And you know, all Don could do is wait till we could go home. And we were staying with a friend, so we went back to the house, and there was a prophet there. And I remember this. And I sat there, and I looked like death. You know, because I said to the Lord, Lord, I always do this because there's fruit. Hmm. And so Donna says, I'm going to bed, and you know, we were both crushed. And he looked at me and says, you know what the Lord's trying to teach you? And I says, no, I do not, and I do not want to know. No, I don't want to know, I don't care, I'm fed up. And he kept on pushing me, you know, like prophet. And I realized the truth. I don't do this because of fruit, which I had always been told was a test. The test. I do this out of obedience. Yeah. You see, I do this out of obedience. Mm-hmm. And it's very lonely, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's very, very lonely. You all understand this. You're here, you understand this. Story. Okay, get on the mic. Yeah.
Terry and I started our ministry. We were prophesied over that we would have a healing ministry, and it basically didn't happen for 14 years. And finally, when it did happen, it really started real big and everything, and then everybody just abandoned us. And I mean, it came... Bad things happened. People said things and just abandoned it. So it was just Terry, myself, and my daughter.
Yeah, praise God. I have a wife and children.
It was the same thing. I refused to quit. You know, people said, just quit. It's, you know, it's done. And we were like, no, I do this out of obedience. The Lord said to do this. So we did. We continued to go. And then now we have, you know, several, the ministry's flourishing right now. So.
You know, as a Baptist pastor, I preached through 1st and 2nd Samuel, and I got to that scripture where Samuel said to Saul, I want you to go and wait for 7 days. And so he goes and he waits, but he gets to the seventh day, and the people are panicking. And the people want Saul to do something and to sacrifice.
Just reading that.
And so he is disobedient, he sacrifices, he does not wait to Samuel show up. And it says he does this, and then Samuel is there. So we're talking about at the end of 7 days. Mm-hmm. He has almost made it, but he loses the kingdom because he was not obedient.
The whole kingdom.
And that is the most terrifying scripture for me in all the Word of God, because he was not totally obedient. He did not wait. Okay, Sonia, I am feeling fuzz around my face and buzzing in my ears, okay? And Christine, I seem to always see ungodly females bringing forth ungodly babies in dreams. I am curious to know how to deal with these babies before they manifest the next generation, or the ungodly females before they have babies. Christine, would you send that to office at asisplace.com. Let me ponder that, okay? Mm-hmm. So send me your email and I'll respond to that. Okay, I keep on doing this and I feel healing. And this, is this like a scepter or a rod? So I think it's a scepter. Is this the same scepter that you have?
Yeah, I felt it when you said scepter.
Okay, put your, on the mic.
Hey.
I felt scepter in my hand when you said scepter. It seems to be bigger than it was before, though. Before it was a small scepter like this. This time it feels like this.
This scepter is, mine is like this big. Yeah, and yours, yours is. I'm a little, I'm going to be jealous.
It's, if it's yours, healing, you said it was healing. That's our ministry.
This, your scepter is this big.
Wow.
It's like a pillar.
I'm getting really hot right now. I'm burning up.
This is Revelation. Revelation chapter I just came across this. Revelation, see, I have to. Revelation 3.
Mm.
Chuck, this is good.
I was just there.
Revelation 3. Let's start with 3:7. Revelation 3:7. To the angel of the church of Philadelphia write, these things says, he who is holy, he is true. He who has the key of David, he who opens and no one shuts, and shuts and no one opens. I know your work. See, I have set before you an open door, and no one can shut it, for you have a little strength, have kept my word, and have not denied my name. Indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews and are not, but lie. Indeed, I will make them come and worship before your feet and to know that I have loved you. Because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which will come upon the whole earth, to test those who dwell on the earth. Behold, I am coming quickly. Hold fast what you have, that no one may take your
crown.
Crown.
I got that this morning.
He who overcomes, I will make him a pillar. That's what you have. You are holding a pillar that's a scepter. In the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more, and I will write on him the name of my God, and name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God, and I will write on him my new name. Mm-hmm. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Isn't it interesting? We were talking about the idea of overcoming. Overcoming is continuing. And it's very lonely, isn't it? Because you really do not know. I really do not know. Am I crazy?
Yeah.
And there's a fine line between being crazy and faith. There's a very fine line. And people around you, and we lost, I think we probably lost 3 or 4 address book full of friends. But now we're surrounded by wonderful friends, and I might add, who are healthy. So the Lord has returned 100-fold, 1,000-fold to us.
Something to say about that crown.
Yes.
We were in the healing rooms when we didn't have a building. It was in our home. And we were sitting there, and I saw what I now perceive as star instead of an angel.
Okay.
Because of you, thank you. And it came in the room, and it came in the form of like if you saw a Christmas light star. It actually, you could see it with your physical eye. It came over, and it sat between Alicia and I. And then I closed my eyes, and when I closed my eyes, I saw that it was the angel of the Lord. And as he spoke, I knew it was the Lord. And he spoke to me, and he said, this was on 8/13/2005, he said, he gave me a, he said, I'm about to, he says, I got your back, because we were going through all of this.
Mike still.
We were going through all of this, and he said, I got your back, which is an expression today as like, hey, don't worry, I'm with you.
That's right.
And he said, I'm about to increase the anointing in your hand, and then he put a crown on my head, and the crown, he put it on, it looked like a hand. Look like a hand like this, but he put it on like this. And I said, Lord, you're putting it on backwards.
Fivefold.
He says, no, I said I have your back.
Wow.
And so he put it on like that. And then I said, Lord, this is so weird. you really got to give me a word. So he gave me, yeah, because I mean, you know, I'm seeing all this in my mind's eye. So he gave me Isaiah 51:11.
Okay, Isaiah.
Oh, I love that.
51:11, okay?
Isaiah 51:11 says...
It's not, it's a 1:1:1 again.
Close. It is, yeah. Times five, right?
Oh, wow.
The ransom of the Lord will return. They will enter Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads. Gladness and joy will overtake them.
Will overtake.
Overtake them, and sorrow and sighing will flee away. And that's...
Something's happening to us that after we got this, we're going through a deliverance. And you feel it? And it feels tingly to me. What's happening? You feel it? It feels tingly, like dirty. Yeah, it's coming. It's all of us.
You know what? Are you feeling the lips vibrate?
It almost feels like it's also coming off the seven eyes.
Mm-hmm.
So remember, these are the seven eyes, so this is 1, 2, 3, 4, the heart, solar plexus, 6.
These are the eyes that go to.
Yeah,
from.
So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and the groin is 7. So I actually feel the deliverance is coming off of the seven eyes. So Lord, what are you doing? Yes.
The scripture I got right now was hope deferred makes the heart sick.
But desire fulfilled is a tree of life.
And
I'm sorry, I didn't get it.
What I wanted to share really quickly also was David and I, we were talking about how right now our life, it's like we're in a spiritual vacuum, and it's like we're on pause, and we're in that spiritual vacuum, and life is going
and
on.
And do you have a job yet?
The Lord has not released him to go to work. And that's, you know, people can look and say, well, you should be going to
I'm
work.
I'm sure that causes discussions.
Oh, big, major discussions. And so we're like living, we're like in pause, our life is on pause in the spiritual vacuum. But the Lord was saying, he was giving me, in Deuteronomy, when they wandered through the wilderness for 40 years, he said to test, to see if their hearts would be true to the Lord.
That's what it says.
And he says, and then he was telling me about Caleb, that Caleb, when he was 85, he was still the same as when Moses told him, the Lord is going to give you that. And the Lord says, it's very easy when we're out in a platform and everybody sees you, what you're doing. But what happens when you're behind closed doors and nobody sees you? Mm-hmm. He says, but I see you. He says, and all those who put their hope in me won't be ashamed. And he says, mm-hmm. I see what you're doing behind closed doors, and you're believing me, and you're trusting me. That's why when you gave the word last week about asking for the upper and lower springs, and that she asked her father. She didn't the husband didn't go and ask. She asked her father. That's so confirming.
That's a great word. And you know that's repeated. I'm reading through the Bible again.
Ephesians 3.
And it's repeated again in Judges. I did not know that.
Yeah.
In Judges, I think, chapter 2.
Really?
Yeah.
And so that's what the Lord is saying, that no matter what, if we're coming to him and inquiring of him, and we're believing, and he says, Caleb, in all that waiting, he could have grown bitter. It's in what we're doing in between that time to when we're getting to that promised land. And he says, and even when you get to that promised land, he says, you're still going to have to overcome those giants that are now in that place. He says, but it's what you're doing in between to getting to that place. He says, don't let bitterness come. And know that I see, and I'm going to bring it to pass.
And it's very lonely.
True.
Chuck.
I noticed that promotion always comes with a challenge, but the Lord said he'll never allow you to go through anything more than you can handle. And so with promotion comes the ability to handle the thing. It's bigger, and it's not familiar with you, but you'll figure it out.
C.S. Lewis in one of the Chronicles of Narnia, Aslan comes and mauls one of the children. And later, one of the other children says, well, why did you do that? And Aslan, and the word Aslan is the Turkish word for lion, Lion Judah. Aslan responds, I tell each man only his own story. And so for you, you know, what right do I have to come and criticize your walk with the Lord? If you are seeking the Lord with all of your heart, what right do I have to evaluate that? See.
Actually, what I've been getting around, not just our experience before, and it's been something that I've been thought I was operating in before, but come to find out wasn't, to restore a person, and you go back to the root of bitterness, defiling many, and if somebody has fallen from the way or in a sin, what it took to restore them, and if people can't, it's double on them in a way. They can fall into their own stuff, which is, I think, is bitterness.
Yes.
But that's been the key to seeing how can people restore one that has come, you know, fallen in a way somewhere,
uh-huh.
and it's walking with them and seeking the Lord like we're doing now, if there is even a way. But people come by the world or the church or whatever, I call it idolatry, to try to say, no, you're out of line to this. But they can't really bring you into line unless it's spiritual.
Especially you've not been there, because you do not go in yourself. So then how can you lead others to go in? I'm still curious about what this deliverance is. Is anybody feeling this online? Larry, do you feel anything if you're still online? It almost feels electromagnetic. That's what they got to? Okay, we have confirmation here. It's really tingly. So, mindset. No, it's not mindset. What is it, Lord, that you're freeing us from? Okay. Always amazed me, after all these years, there's still deliverance.
This is
Brian.
I'm just letting you know there are many people who are saying they are feeling it. Larry, Tobias, Don, mm-hmm. Sonia.
Okay, great. Thank you. Yes.
Can I read that? I got this morning, and then when Larry said what he said, I think this lines up with the deliverance. Principality is a principle agreed upon as a foundation of deception that has influenced the inheritance sons of God.
Okay, say that again. I got to chew on that. Okay, say that again.
You? Okay. Principality is a principle system agreed upon as a foundation of deception that has influenced the inheritance sons of God.
There you go with that word agreement again. And the reality is we enter into agreement, don't we, with that system. Yeah, but sometimes we're pretty willing.
This is true.
See, what's sad is, though, that then it becomes a seed for the next generation.
Yeah, this is the other.
So this is what we need to do is we need to start putting out the right seeds for the next generation. I have found that we work with the youth, Brian and I, and you know, it's got down to this little band of youth, and it's taken a long time for us, by example, to undo what the Institute Church has put in them. In fact, those that are newer and come outside the Institute Church much more rapidly enter into it than those that don't. And I think this is what we have to offer, that by us doing this together and experimenting on how do we seek the Lord together and how do we do this together, that we then establish a model by which those of the next generation can then learn how to operate in. And I think that is really important. Mm. Sonia, almost like our body coming into alignment with our spirit, also aligning in the fullness of Christ. I agree, Sonia.
You know, I don't know if this really has a lot to do with it or not, but several times a day I pray that the Lord will fill, because he put this on my heart to pray it, so this is the reason why I pray it, that the Lord will send out billions of angels, you know, from the center of the earth all the way to the top of the second atmosphere to change the atmosphere into fear of the Lord. And that we would all line up with his harmonics, with his colors, and with his what his vibration.
Yes.
Because, you know, we've gotten so perverted by the world and by the harmonics of the world that we don't understand anymore the what he's trying to say, or we can't even hear him because there's so much interference in the atmosphere.
Hey.
So I don't know if that has anything to do with it, but when she said that, that kind of reminded me of that prayer that we always pray every day, you know, that, and I pray it like 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 times a day. Lord, just release those angels, release those angels. And, you know, it was interesting because at first I was like, well, you know, this was kind of a prayer I was praying. You know, I didn't really, I didn't have the connection between it. But one day he said, then no one will have an excuse, will they?
No.
And so I realized that by allowing everyone to line up with this harmonics, you know, this was something he was commissioning me to do. I mean, I'm only one of a billion intercessors out there, and I'm sure there's other intercessors that are praying that prayer.
I don't know there's a billion, but
yeah, you know, but you know what I'm saying.
Several.
Yeah, you know. So, but it just happened that made me feel that was why he was having us pray.
But that. You see, we all do our part, don't we? So that's when we're under the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, we do our part. And a general or a 5-star general sees the big picture. The soldiers do not have the big picture. All they have is to follow orders. And you are to do what you are to do. And when we all do what we're supposed to do, it's then the war is won. Yes.
The word says one puts 1,000 to flight.
That's right. And 2, 10,000. Exponential increase of agreement. Yes.
Paul, I was getting, when you're talking about seeds, I was getting this about the wheat and the tares, and that the fields were ripe with harvest, but the angels came in, and I was wondering about that, but I started seeing the threshing floor. They had to get the tare away from the wheat, so they had to harvest it, and then that was burned, meaning
That's
those
right.
seeds, and then the seed out of the wheat was whatever we want to say, stored up. Or whatever we had to do, and that's what I felt that was going on with that deliverance.
The Lord's removing tares from us. Oh. The contamination of generations. Jen, I think that verse of Genesis is fascinating, isn't it?
It is.
That we have reaped the harvest of our ancestors, and it is not a good harvest. And when something's repeated so long as in a fractal, you think that's the way it's supposed to be. And to come out from under that and to go into a new way of thinking, which is actually the original way of thinking, is a hard thing to do. Incidentally, going back to that Harvard study, you have the initiators or the word they actually use. But it's actually a bell curve, so we'll do it like this so you can see it. So over here is the initiators, and then you have the initial followers, and then eventually you reach the high point of the bell curve where then all of a sudden everybody agrees. And then it goes back down, and then you have initiators again. When I was in seminary, I read a book called Enthusiasm, and it was an old book. And it was a very fascinating book. He said that the denominations follow the same pattern. They get bigger, 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 bigger. People get fed up. They go back to the homes. They have Bible studies. Then those Bible studies start growing. They start growing. They get bigger, bigger. Then they move into a building. And pretty soon you have a bulletin. And then you have organization. And people get fed up with it. And it goes back down. And I won't mention the denomination now, but back in the early 70s, the Jesus movement, there was a movement that started. They met in a tent. And I was at Downey First Baptist, so I was already in the system, American Baptist system. And I walked in. I was on staff then. I walked in, and in my box, this church, and there was a bulletin there. I thought, it has already begun. That's the first thing that came to my mind. They've already started to institutionalize, and now they are. And you see, this is the pattern. Since I've become aware of this, I've said to the Lord, I do not want to stop. And I easily could have stopped. We had enough, you know, we could have stayed with deliverance, and I could have turned that into the ministry, and I could have stopped there. But it's like the Lord kept on pushing, say, you are not to stop. And the Lord continues to change. Because you see, Aslan is always on the move. That's one of the phrases in the Chronicles of Narnia. He's always on the move. And we have to be really cautious that we do not grab the current revelation, package it, and then solidify it, and then we set up our tent. This is what Peter, James, and John want to do, isn't it? Let us build a tabernacle here. Oh, I just thank you, Holy Spirit. I think that's a great analogy. We want to set up our tent, establish our church, and build on that. And then, of course, what happens is we milk it until pretty soon it's dead. But then we keep on going. Okay, just shifted. Jan, do you have something?
Yeah.
Okay, and then I think we're finished.
Oh, okay. So, again, this is what I feel the Lord is saying. I just kind of wrote this out. You are a new creation, a re-creative design to birth the true seeds from the divine line. Not a GMO and not from the world.
What's a GMO?
GMO, genetically modified.
Okay, organism.
Organism. Not a GMO and not from the world, so the truth will flourish by a river that is here. The original design is a foundation of stones that are laid to establish the truth by the price he has paid. I call you a wall, a setting in gold. It is from the sure foundation, for the world to behold.
Did you just get that?
Yeah.
That was excellent. Would you send that to me?
Yeah.
So we'll send it out in our notes.
Okay.
Father, we thank you for what you've done the last 2 hours. Lord, you are so amazing, the journey you take us on.
Mm.
And we do not know what we're going to do. Lord, we bless your name. And I believe, Lord, that we are in agreement here as your people that we want to be kingdom people. And we acknowledge you as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Mm-hmm.
That we want to do what you want us to do. We praise your name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Do you want to find me? Come through that open door. Don't be afraid to ask of me. Come through the open door.